welcome to this edition of VBS Neuro Med. The topic we are covering in this series is the spinal cord, the gray matter details. Now, highlighted here is the head-shaped or the butterfly-shaped gray matter. We know it contains neuronal cell bodies, their axons, dendrites, and autosynaptic connections. It also contains neuroglia and blood vessels. It's surrounded by white matter, which is virtually a zone of tracts ascending and descending. We are familiar with the words anterior horn and posterior horn. These are the two major components of the gray matter. But this is in a section, we can call it as anterior and posterior horn. But when you look at the entire spinal cord, this is there at every level. So therefore, it will be more appropriate to use the terms anterior gray column and posterior gray column. Now, the anterior gray column has motor neurons, the axons of which go out of the spinal cord into the anterior rootlets to go to the various parts of the body. It's a cluster of motor neurons. In fact, some of the large motor neurons are seen in this zone. Posterior horn contains neurons which are associated with sensory functions. Receives the primary afferent fibers that enter the cord via the dorsal rootlets. Cell bodies of these incoming fibers lie in the segmental dorsal root ganglion. There is a lateral horn in certain restricted segments which contains the cell bodies of the sympathetic neurons, part of the autonomic nervous system, preganglionic sympathetic neurons. Next, in addition to this architecture, in front and behind the central canal, the gray matter of the two sides are interconnected. That's called the anterior and the posterior gray commissure. Now, when you look at the gray matter in finer details, you will notice that although it's full of neurons, sensory neurons and motor neurons, they are aggregated into cell clusters, neuron clusters, which we call them as nuclei. Further, each of these nuclei seems to be more oriented with a particular type of function, either in terms of connection with somewhere or in terms of controlling some part or some item, something like that. Basically, we are going to identify these neuron clusters, which we have called it as nuclei. We'll also try to see how far we can try to remember them in a functional context. You see, identifying these neurons is like identifying on a map various important landmarks in a town or a city or a state. We always open an atlas or a photograph and then we try to say this is this. Same thing here we are going to attempt. But look at it in a slightly another context. These neurons we can divide into three groups: a ventral gray column, a dorsal gray column, and an intermediate gray column. Three parts, I repeat: ventral, dorsal, and intermediate gray column. Now, let's put back all the nuclei. We have color-coded these nuclei into three groups. Remember, these are not from any standard color code. I have used random colors, but made sure that all the yellow is ventral, all the red is dorsal, and all the pink is intermediate. Now, each of these nucleus is a hub. That means it's a cluster of neurons. Fibers from outside reach these neuron clusters. Fibers from here go out of this. It's like an airport hub. That means in an airport you have incoming flights, outgoing flights, etc. Same, somewhat similar, easier. You see, there are arrival and departure photo boards shown here. And on this side, I haven't shown you one particular nucleus as an example. You can see the incoming flight and you can see the outgoing flight. In other words, it's a network. All these hubs are interconnected with each other. They are also interconnected with hubs outside this territory. Therefore, it's a very good example to consider these as airport hubs. Slowly, it's only a matter of the next few slides is going to be naming these hubs, trying to see what each hub is associated with. Like for example, if you say Dubai, well, we know that Emirates, all the flights, it's a hub for that. It's also a place where other airlines also land and take off. But you know, it's generally closely associated with Emirates. Or if you take Abu Dhabi, it's more of Etihad flights. Something like that. You know, we are trying to associate these hubs with certain destinations or certain names of the airlines or something like that. Same thing here. We'll try to, at best, try to, one, identify the nuclei. Try as much as possible to associate with something either in terms of structure or function or destination, something like that. Let's begin with the ventral gray horn. Now, the medial group, the ventral gray horn, is divided into, I showed you those yellow circles or ovals. Now, we will further divide it into a medial group, a lateral group and a central group. There is no place to label, so I kept the label a little away. Nevertheless, the flashing structures are the components of the central group. Next, we'll try to see a little more in detail. The medial group can be further divided into dorsomedial and ventromedial nuclei. Dorsomedial and ventromedial nuclei. Looks like these are nuclei closely associated with supply of the axial musculature. Axial musculature. Next, the lateral nuclei. There are three I showed you in the previous slide. Let's name them from below upwards. I have given a corresponding mirror flash on the opposite side. The names are ventrolateral, dorsolateral, and retrodorsolateral. Looks like these are more associated with limb musculature. Even here, some amount of delineation of work seems to be emerging. Like for example, the ventrolateral may be associated more with motor control of the arm and the thigh area. The dorsolateral may be associated with control of forearm and the leg area. The rest of the upper and the lower limb, namely the hand and the foot, is the domain of the retrodorsolateral nucleus. That means, in spite of structural division, there is also faint evidence that there seems to be some kind of a functional sharing. That means some areas are meant for certain territories. Next, the central group has two nuclei. The round one is the phrenic nucleus, and the other one below, accessory spinal nucleus. Slowly we are also beginning to realize, the moment you say phrenic nucleus, it's obvious that it's going to control the diaphragm, and the nucleus below that is the accessory spinal nucleus, which controls the two head and neck muscles, sternocleidomastoid and trapezius. Obviously, this nuclei may not be seen all over the spinal cord. It will be seen in the cervical region. In other words, although this is a generalized diagram or description of various nuclei, we are now beginning to introduce the point that one or more of these nuclei may be present at discrete areas along the spinal cord, and more importantly, missing in certain other areas. However, there are certain nuclei which are present through and through the spinal cord. This is a very, very important point. Dorsal gray column. Now, there are three nuclei. Substantia propria, a comma-shaped one, right at the tip of the dorsal horn. Next, nucleus proprius and the dorsal nucleus. Now, the substantia gelatinosa receives the incoming sensory fibers. Remember, now we are in the dorsal horn, so we will no more talk about motor neurons. These are going to be more sensory in function. They are going to receive fibers from the dorsal root ganglion. The substantia nigra receives the inputs from the dorsal root ganglion, those fibers coming in. It seems to be some kind of a filtering nucleus, which subsequently sends it to the deeper nuclei, namely the nucleus proprius. Remember, the nucleus proprius is closely associated with the spinothalamic tract, whereas the substantia nigra is associated with this. It makes sure that only certain types of information are given to the nucleus proprius. The dorsal nucleus is more closer to the base of the dorsal horn, maybe little posterolateral to the central canal. Now, this nucleus is possibly closely associated with the spinocerebellar tract. I repeat, spinocerebellar tract. This is a first lecture, so don't worry too much technical details about the tracts and the functions. Try to concentrate on the identification or spotters of the various nuclei. Next, there is a very tiny one additional nucleus superficial to the substantia, the one we discussed previously. That's the posteromarginal nucleus. Now, that nucleus is very, very thin, and it is there as the dorsal root fibers come into the spinal cord. A word about the intermediate gray column, nothing much, but remember, this intermediate column is divided into intermedio medial and intermedio lateral nucleus. The intermedio lateral nucleus is found in the lumbar region, thoracolumbar region, I repeat, and that's the area that gives the lateral horn in the thoracic regions, thoracolumbar regions, which we have just a little while back in the early part of the discussion mentioned that the sympathetic preganglionic neurons are located there. Likewise, the intermedio-medial is seen in the sacral segments, and the corresponding preganglionic sympathetic neurons are located here. That means these two nuclei are autonomic nervous system related. That means they are related to the sympathetic component of the autonomic nervous system. Next, now all the nuclei are back in position. This is just a recap. We had gone into details, then a little more in detail. Now we are back to the same old starting photograph. Now we see that area is a little difficult for spotters because there are too many things. And there are two groups of nuclei, ventral and intermediate. While it may be easy to draw, it may be difficult actually to identify and remember those names. I hope you have some mnemonic or some kind of a method by which you can take note or remember the names. Okay, try to build your own mnemonics. With this brief introduction of the gray column, I would like to take leave, but note that this is not all. There is much more to be covered. We will do it in the next few installments of videos. For example, this gray column can also be viewed in another research context as a series of laminae. We will not call them by discrete names of the nuclei, but rather in terms of, you know, lamina 1, lamina 2. This is another. We will try to do that. We will also try to correlate roughly which discrete nucleus that we have named in this video correlates with which lamina. I mean, there is much more to be done in this lecture, which we will cover in the next few videos. Thank you, friends. I wish you all the very best, and I hope that the classes will begin as soon as possible. Remember, we are going through a very, very difficult stage in this pandemic control, not only in our city Bangalore but across the world. Let's pray that things will be under control in due course. I hope these lectures are of benefit to you. Thank you.